co-dimension one quasi-convective, which means basically geometrically nicely embedded subgroup whose boundary separates those two points. If for any two points in the boundary you could find a co-dimensional one subset that kind of cuts those two points apart from the viewpoint of the boundary, then you can find sufficiently many co-dimension one subgroups so that when you apply Saghib's construction, you actually get a proper and co-compact action on the dual cube complex. Okay, so. So you have to be able to find these co-dimensional subgroups. It's not so easy. Conor Markovich did the hard work though over here, and so as a corollary of Conor Markovich's theorem, if you have a closed hyperbolic free manifold, then the fundamental of that closed hyperbolic free manifold acts freely and co-compactly on a cat zero cube complex. Okay, so every hyperbolic free manifold, its fundamental group is actually the fundamental group of a non-positively curved cube complex. So I'll continue racing forward at page every 3 minutes. I'm going to do a slight detour now. A group has a hierarchy if the group can be built from, say, trivial groups by using a finite sequence of amalgamated free products and HNN extensions. So these are just sort of mild generalizations of the notion of a free product, right? You're building a group from smaller groups by gluing them together along a subgroup. These are sort of the groups with hierarchies are the groups that you can build. That's the way to think about it. Groups with hierarchies are the ones that you can build by basic constructions. It is a quasi-convex hierarchy if when you build your group, you're always gluing together your subgroups, say A and B, glued together along C. So you see C is a subgroup of A and C is a subgroup of B, and you're taking the new group that you get, which is generated by A and B, but where the copy of C on one side is identified with the copy of C in A is identified with the copy of C in B. So if C is actually quasi-isometrically embedded, which means that the geometry of the intrinsic geometry of C is basically the same as its extrinsic geometry inside the amalgam. At each stage, then we call this hierarchy a quasi-convex hierarchy. So I just give you one example. So in topology, we know about hierarchies of low-dimensional manifolds. So a surface has a hierarchy. You keep on cutting the surface along circles, let's say, until you end up with a bunch of balls. Right? Or you can do the same thing perhaps to a three-manifold if you're lucky enough to have a Hockham three-manifold. So when you perform this sequence of cuts, if you're always cutting along pylon injective objects, then on the level of group theory you get a hierarchy for the fundamental group. Okay, so I kind of illustrated that. So you start off with a surface group, it's an amalgam of two free groups amalgamating a cyclic subgroup. Each free group is an amalgam of two cyclic subgroups identifying a trivial group. Each cyclic group is an HNN extension of a trivial group. Okay, that's the hierarchy for a surface group. So a theorem that I proved, I announced it to the world, whatever that means, about five years ago. If G is a hyperbolic group with a quasi-convex hierarchy, then G is virtually special. So if you have a hyperbolic group and it has a quasi-convex hierarchy, so it's kind of buildable in this nice way, then it is actually virtually, it has a finite index subgroup with the property that it lives inside of a rag. Very strange thing. In fact, there's a relatively hyperbolic version of this, which applies in certain cases, but it applies in particular to hyperbolic three manifolds with cusps. So not a closed hyperbolic three manifold, which is what we were hearing about in Eagle's talk, but a three manifold that has some boundary, let's say. So we got this wonderful application that every hyperbolic three manifold with boundary has a finite index subgroup that lives inside of a rag. Okay, this is kind of shocking news to unexpected, I think, because it doesn't seem it seems you know, to be trivializing a subject. Okay, except that rads have lots of, it really tells you that rads have many, many subgroups. Another theorem, which is kind of really basically a consequence of this theorem about hyperbolic groups or the quasi-convex hierarchy, is that every one-related group with torsion is residually finite. This was an open problem, it was conjectured by Baumslag around 1968. If you take just a one-related group, that's a group that has a presentation with just one defining relation, if that defining relation is a proper power, then Baumslag guessed on the basis of maybe a few examples that that group would be residually finite, which means that every element survives in some finite quotient. It's maybe strange to see, it may be strange, so this is something that maybe the group theory was a kind of expected or hoped for property in the combinatorial group theory world. The theorem about hyperbolic three manifolds with cusps, and actually certain closed hyperbolic three manifolds as well, but not all of them, was a bit of a surprise, I think, outside of me and my circle of collaborators, I guess. But it's strange to see that they're actually quite closely related to each other, okay? Because they're both connected to this business of quasi-convex groups with quasi-convex hierarchies, are virtually embedded rags. Okay, so this is a tough slide. So I apologize for it, but I just want to give you a little bit of a flavor very quickly of some of the ingredients, and to mention especially important work with my co-authors. Among the ingredients that went into proving this theorem about groups with quasi-convex hierarchy, one of them is a specializing amalgam. So this is basically saying that if you have a compact non-positively curved cube complex, here it is right over here, this object over here, and you happen to find an immersed hyperplane which embeds inside and actually has a two-sided neighborhood, just as illustrated, and its fundamental group is malnormal, so that means that it intersects its conjugates trivially. When you cut it out, when you remove the open neighborhood of that hyperplane, the complementary components are non-positively curved cube complexes, they certainly are, which are virtually special, then you know that the amalgam is virtually special. You'll know that your original cube complex is virtually special. So I pity you all for hearing me speak about this, I'm sorry. It takes having experience telling people about this for now quite a number of years, even people that are experts, I know that it takes like three or four times to hear it, but that's the way it is with all math. It's all torture. We should all have gone to that movie about why we hate math, right? But actually, maybe you're getting the same treatment here. So, cumulating amalgams. So, maybe this one's a little easier to understand. This is with Tim Chu. This basically says that if you have an amalgamated product, let's say, an amalgamated product, so G is A amalgamated with B along C, and if C is malnormal and quasi-convex, if A and B are virtually compact special, meaning that they are fundamental groups of compact compact special cube complexes, or they're virtually fundamental groups of compact special cube complexes, if A and B are virtually compact special, then G is virtually compact special. I left out the word virtually up here. Then G is the fundamental group. No, I got it right. If A and B are virtually compact special, then G is the fundamental group of a compact non-positively curved cube complex. Okay, I put one example over here, just to sort of make this real. I took and maybe you'll see it's not really, this theorem is a little bit interesting already in some very simple cases. So what is this group over here? It has A and B and C and D, right? So those are two free groups. And the presentation says that A, B, A, B, B is identified with C, D, C inverse, D inverse. So this is an amalgamated product of two free groups where you identify one cyclic subgroup with another. Very simple example. And this theorem is telling you that this group over here is the fundamental group of a compact non-positively curved cube complex. So hopefully that example breathes some life into this cumulating amalgams theorem. So these two theorems together are sort of, they might seem very similar, but they're quite different. They play very different roles. And hand in hand, they're working together to prove some special case of that quasi-convex hierarchy theorem. The other theorem that's worth mentioning that is a very important ingredient for me is a so-called special quotient theorem that Hegel mentioned, because it's been useful again. This basically says that if your group is hyperbolic and virtual compact special, so it's the fundamental group, the non-positively, it's hyperbolic and it is the fundamental group of a cube complex that has a finite cover, which is special. If you have such a group, a virtually compact special group, and you take a quasi-convex subgroup H, then what you can do is you can kill a finite index subgroup of H, you can kill a finite index subgroup H prime of H, and you get a new group that is virtually compact special. So this special quotient theorem says you've got you have your group which is virtually special, and you have your group. He's flashing 5-minute sign, right? I'm following my app over here, so I'm okay. So if you have a group that is virtually compact special and you have a subgroup, then you can kill the subgroup and get a new group that is virtually compact special. So I'm illustrating that with this example over here. So for instance, if you take a free group, right, it's a fundamental group of a graph, which is a special cube complex, and you take an element, ABABB, then you can raise that element to a high power and kill it. And you get a new group, which is virtually compact special. So the last ingredient that I'll just make a glancing reference to it, but it's a formidable business actually, is a kind of high dimensional generalization of small cancellation theory, which is an important tool in combinatorial group theory. And I made one that works with cube complexes and is quite pretty, if I may say. And it joins theories of Gromov, Osen, Groves Manning, Nachmani Girardel, and other people who've made such generalizations of small cancellation theory. Okay, enough of that transparency. We survived it. So let's get back to theorem of Hegel, which kind of completed my sort of vision of what's happening over here and what you can do with cubes, at least in the hyperbolic setting. Something I was really desperate to prove and working towards, and he beat me to it, introducing a beautiful new ingredient that he just barely was sketching at the end of his talk on the first day of the conference. If you have a compact, non-positively curved cube complex whose fundamental group is hyperbolic, then that cube complex has a finite cover, which is special. Okay. And this theorem, which I've proven various special cases towards, and it was really quite clear that was the thing to try to do, around 2009, 2010, this theorem comes with all sorts of fabulous consequences. Okay, one of which is certainly what we heard about that every closed hyperbolic free manifold is virtually Hocken, right? Because, as I told you from Bergeron and myself, as a consequence of Kon-Markovitch, closed hyperbolic free manifolds are fundamental groups of non-positively curved cube complexes. So you can get from this theorem that since they're virtually special, they're also virtually Hocken. Then, because of a result of Hegel, they're virtually fibered as well. They have all sorts of other nice properties. But another wonderful, fabulous result is that random groups are all virtually special. They're all virtually special. They're all residually finite as a consequence. So if you take a three generator group and 17 relators, look up your words in the dictionary, take 100 words from the dictionary in a three-letter alphabet and make a presentation, I can guarantee you that, with a 99.99999% probability, that the group that you get is virtually special because of this whole theory. It's quite magnificent, actually. So, I made it. So now we can sort of look at this scheme for understanding a group and think about what it means. Let's spell it out together and think of me, know what it means. So the first, you know, step is to find sufficiently many codimensional segments. This is a scheme for understanding a group. I have to say, this does not always work. There are many groups that you can't understand in this way, but it works quite a bit. You find a sufficiently many codimensional subgroups, right? So in the case of real excitement, this is Kahn and Markovich did that. They found many codimension one immersed submanifolds, that, right? You accumulate to obtain the action of the group on a cat zero cube complex. That was using Sagiev's construction, right? Enabled with Nicolas Bergeron. Then if the codimension one subgroups are good enough, which they are because of Kahn Markovich, then the group acts nicely. Will act nicely. So your group is the fundamental group of a compact non-positive curved cube complex. And then you find a finite index subgroup so that you're basically finding a finite cover of a compact non-positive curved cube complex, which is special. This is the last ingredient that in this case was contributed by Egel. And from there you get that your group lives inside of a rad, a very, very strange thing that we're still getting used to. Thank you very much for listening to me.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions? Yeah.
Finitely generated fully residually free groups, they are virtually special. Are they special?
They're all virtually special.
But do you know?
I don't know if they're special. I don't know if they're special, but they're all virtually special. Are there any other questions? We still have 4 minutes and 7 seconds.
Any questions?
Excuse me? I can take some of the water now. That's a good idea. Yes?
Obviously, these cubic complexes work very well for the problem that we're trying to solve. But what was the original motivation for studying these cubic complexes?
Well, that's a very interesting question. So the question is, what was the original motivation for studying these cubic complexes? In fact, these cube complexes were introduced to the world of geometric group theory by Gromov in his 1987 essay on hyperbolic groups. He introduced them just as a convenient source of high-dimensional examples, because it was hard to build cat zero spaces in high dimensions, with the exception of cube complexes, were a very large source of high-dimensional cat zero spaces. I cannot believe that he realized at the time how important they were going to become. They have become, in a way, quite central in the field. In geometric group theory, they are central players now, in three-manifold theory, obviously, as well. So they were introduced sort of on what looks like as a whim, on a whim by a great genius. On the other hand, for me, you know, why did I start over here? And that's a very interesting question. I started in two ways, but maybe just so that I can answer the question quickly. Max Dane gave a presentation where many of us are familiar with the Verdinger presentation for the fundamental group of a knot complement. But Max Dane gave a different presentation, which is Dane's presentation, and for prime alternating links, Dane's presentation gave you a two complex, which was a non-positively curved two-dimensional square complex, in fact. So it actually really goes back to Dane. Could you put that back on? Never mind. So in fact, I started at, thank you. So in fact, I mentioned to you that right over here, any subcomplex of the product of two graphs is special. Seems like a very innocuous class. Take two graphs, look at their product, and take a subcomplex of that. Doesn't seem like much, is there? But in fact, for every prime alternating link, okay, those are, you know, over under knots and links. For every prime alternating link, if you use the non-positively curved cube complex given by Max Dehn, what you find is that, what I proved is that it has a finite cover, which is a subcomplex of the product of two graphs. And what I believe is, I really believe that every cusped hyperbolic free manifold has a fundamental group, which is a subgroup of the which has fundamental group, which is isomorphic to the fundamental group of a subcomplex of the product of two graphs. It's a disaster, actually, in a way, because it's you're studying these hyperbolic manifolds, and you think that it's such a rich source of possibilities, and yet it's looking like they're all just silly. They're all silly. So, are there any other questions?
Comments or questions?
It's over.
So, thank you. Professor Daniel Weiss from McGill University. He got his PhD from Princeton University in 1996. He also got the Oswald Veblen Prize last year. Today, he will speak on the cubical route to understanding groups. Please.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here, and I'm grateful to be able to speak in front of so many distinguished people. So I'm going to tell you about the cubical route to understanding groups. Basically, what I'm going to tell you about is a scheme for understanding a group. I'm going to outline the scheme for you right now. And see, there are still some people coming in, so maybe we started a minute or so early. But that's okay, because at the end, I'm going to review this, so we'll give them another chance. So the scheme for understanding a group is, first of all, to find a bunch of codimension one subgroups, and then to obtain an action of your group on a cat zero cube complex. And hopefully, if your codimension one subgroups are nice enough, and if they're geometrically nice enough, then your group will act with good finiteness properties. So you might hope that it will act properly and co-compactly, for instance. Then the next step is to attempt to find a finite index subgroup G prime with a property that X tilde quotiented by G prime is very organized. It's what we call a special cube complex. And at that point, you're in very good shape, because G prime, which is the fundamental group of that quotient complex, is actually a subgroup of a right-angled Artin group. And since right-angled Artin groups, RAGs, are very easy groups, you obtain some nice properties for your original group G. So I realize, on the one hand, let me say first of all that this has basically been my research program, what I've outlined over here, for quite a long time. Even before I really understood what it was that I was doing, I started somewhere somewhere between 3 and 5, but not 4. And I didn't really quite know what I was doing, but pretty much from day one, this is what I was doing, and it became clear, quite clear, what it was as I started to collect the ingredients. It became quite clear what was going on, and what the goals were, and what the correct levels of generality about 10 years ago. So you might have seen This echoed in Egel's talk on the first day, and so it might seem familiar to you now. My goal is going to be to sort of now tell you what all of those things meant and then see how those ingredients fit together. Okay? So first of all, a cube complex is you take a bunch of cubes, right? A cube is what you think it is. You take a bunch of cubes and you glue them together along subcubes. So I've indicated a zero-dimensional subcube and a two-dimensional subcube of that three cube over there. And so you just go ahead and glue together a bunch of cubes to get something like on the upper right. That's just a cube complex. And we're going to define, following Gromov, what it means for a cube complex to be non-positively curved. To do that, first we need to say what a flat complex is. It's very simple. It's a simplicial complex with a property that a bunch of vertices span an n-simplex if and only if they are pairwise adjacent. So it's basically it's a simplicial complex which is determined by its one skeleton in the sense that if you think you see a simplex, it's actually there. If you see the one skeleton of a simplex, it's there. Okay, so the simple example is an octahedron, or maybe a four-cycle with a kind of, those three edges attached is another example. The link of a zero cube inside of a cube complex is the simplicial complex that kind of corresponds to the epsilon sphere about that zero cube. It's, if you're at a zero cube in a cube complex, you kind of look out into the surrounding cubes and you see just corners of cubes, right? And each corner of a cube is going to be an appropriate dimension simplex, right? So you're looking out from your zero cube, you see a bunch of simplices all glued together. So that's what a link is. And a cube complex is non-positively curved if the link of each zero cube is a flat complex. That's the definition. It takes a little while to get used to, but it's a very simple definition. A little motivation for the idea of this combinatorial idea of curvature comes from looking at just surfaces and what you're accustomed to thinking of three squares around the vertex, right? The link of that vertex in a sphere is just a cycle of length three, right? And it's too small, and there's no two simplex over there, so it's not a flat complex. That's a positively curved situation. On the other hand, that's right over here is a kind of positively curved situation. Here's a flat situation, right? The link of this is zero cube is a cycle of length four. It's just right, and here's a negatively curved situation. So some other examples: any graph is a non-positively curved cube complex. Any closed surface is homeomorphic to a non-positively curved cube complex, except for a couple of nasty cases. Just to give you a little bit more of some ideas to have in mind, if you take two non-positively curved cube complexes and take their product, it's again a non-positively curved cube complex. Okay, so the Cartesian product of two graphs is an example of a cube complex, of a non-positively curved cube complex. Okay, so I've told you what cube complexes were. Now I'm going to tell you what right-angled Artin groups are. It's very simple. You just take a graph and you get a presentation for a group. The generators of your group, so your graph is going to be gamma. You get a group A of gamma, the Artin group associated to gamma. Its generators are just going to be the vertices of the graph, and two generators commute if and only if they correspond to vertices that are joined by an edge. So for instance, over here, the Artin group associated to this graph right over here is z cubed, right? Because you have three generators, and any two of which commute. For this one over here, it's f2 cross f3, because you have two generators on the left, which commute with the three generators on the right. Okay? So I'll just mention now that any right-angled Artin group is actually the fundamental group of a non-positively curved cube complex called a Salvetti complex. And it's basically, you build it by gluing a bunch of cubes together. Whenever you see a collection of pairwise of n pairwise commuting generators, you add an n cube in the form of a torus. It's a very simple thing. I'm not going to get involved in it, but it's going to be very important for us. Okay, so these Salvetti complexes, which are associated to these rads, are also non-positively curved cube complexes. A cat zero cube complex now is a simply connected non-positively curved cube complex. Okay, so this is, I've already defined the non-positively curved cube complex. If you take its universal cover, you get what we call a cat zero cube complex. They're called cat zero cube complexes because they have so-called cat zero metrics. They are geodesic metric spaces. Any two points, so what you can do is you can give each cube the expected Euclidean metric, and then that determines a path metric, which is a geodesic metric, and you know the distance to get from one point to another. You just kind of take the minimal sequence of jumps, little geodesics through the cubes, and you look for the shortest possible such path. This geodesic metric satisfies what's called the cat zero inequality. That just means that geodesic triangles inside of your cat zero cube complex, so here's a geodesic triangle inside of a cat zero cube complex, is at least as thin as a geodesic triangle in the Euclidean plane with the same side lengths. Okay, so that's not going to be that important to us, but it does give you a sense of what we're talking about over here. So this picture, which you might have thought was the hyperbolic plane, it's not quite the hyperbolic plane. It's just quasi close to being the hyperbolic plane, because it actually any little bit of it looks like a little Euclidean square. Okay, so you know what a cat zero cube complex is now, and I wrote it at the top. These are generalized trees. It's very true. That's actually what these are. These are higher dimensional generalizations of trees. So now we'll talk about why that is justified. So I'm going to tell you what hyperplanes are. First of all, a mid-cube in a cube, it's a very simple thing. It's just the subspace of the cube that you get by restricting exactly one coordinate to zero. Right. So you saw that that I define cubes to be a product of minus 1, 1, right? So now that this is the reason. Okay, so this 3 cube over here, it has three different mid-cubes, right? According to, your three ways of cutting through it. And a hyperplane in a cat zero cube complex is a connected subspace that intersects each cube in either a mid-cube or, it doesn't intersect the cube, or in the empty set. So I've drawn one example. See this blue subspace over here, and as you can see, if it ever intersects a cube, it actually intersects it at an entire mid-cube. Okay? The way to sort of imagine these things is you imagine sort of starting someplace, maybe starting inside of this little mid-cube right over here, and then extending outwards, and you're sort of forced to continue in a particular way. And fortunately enough, you don't come back and cross into yourself. Okay, these are basic properties, not very difficult to prove. So every mid-cube lies in a hyperplane. Each hyperplane, cuts your cat zero cube complex. And actually, it's hyperplanes that give a cat zero cube complex its personality. These hyperplanes generalize the role of edges in a tree. So what makes a tree into a tree is that you can cut the tree in half with each edge, right? Or actually, if you want, the center of every edge cuts it into a left half and a right half. And likewise, in a cat zero cube complex, each hyperplane, like this red hyperplane right over here, in this yellow cat zero cube complex, it cuts it in half. And you're familiar with the hyperplanes inside of this copy of Euclidean space, and also the hyperplanes inside of this tree. Okay, so you know what hyperplanes are now. Okay, and you have a little bit of a sense of what cat zero cube complexes are. Now I'm gonna tell you what special cube complexes were. I mentioned them earlier. They're these organized cube complexes. So if immersed hyperplanes are kind of like hyperplanes. So an immersed hyperplane in a non-positively curved cube complex is kind of like a hyperplane in X tilde. And what you should just think of is you should just imagine a mid-cube, right? Like this little red mid-cube right over here, and then just continue following along to the neighboring mid-cubes and wandering around. It's kind of like an immersed surface inside of a three-manifold, for instance, or an immersed circle inside of a surface. Okay, so that's an immersed hyperplane. It might self-cross, right? It might intersect. It might contain more than one mid-cube inside of a cube. So a cube complex, a non-positively curved cube complex, is special. It's a very strange-looking definition. If it's immersed hyperplanes do not have certain pathologies that I'm going to list, those pathologies are, no hyperplane self-crosses, so each hyperplane actually embeds, No hyperplane is one-sided. You don't have like a Möbius strip, right? It is two-dimensional suggestive pictures, right? So the regular neighborhood, the tubular neighborhood of a hyperplane is actually a product. It has a product neighborhood, okay? No hyperplane self-osculates. So a hyperplane is not allowed to sort of travel around somewhere and then come back and just kind of touch itself again, right? If you like, hyperplanes are sort of passing through certain one cubes, right? And you don't have it doesn't pass through two different one cubes that are that are adjacent to the same vertex. And finally, no pair of hyperplanes interosculate. So to interosculate means that they intersect in one spot. This red and pink hyperplane, they interosculate. They cross over here and they kind of osculate over there. They come right up next to each other, kind of tangent to each other without crossing again. Okay, so this is a strange definition, I acknowledge, but it turns out to be very natural and useful. I'll give you one example. Any subcomplex of the product of two graphs is special. So if you take the product of two graphs, it's a very, I know everybody here knows what that means, okay, you have no choice, and you just take a subcomplex of the product of two graphs, so there are many such subcomplexes, doesn't seem like a very rich class, I know, but there are many of them. It is actually a special cube complex. You could check that you don't have any of these pathologies in its hyperplanes. And this class turns out to be extraordinarily rich from the viewpoint of where we're going, which is towards three manifolds. Okay, so Friedrich Haglund and I, about 12 years ago, defined this notion of a special cube complex, and we actually showed that if X is special, then being special is the same thing as admitting a local isometry to the Salvetti complex of a rag. Okay, so since local isometries of non-positively curved things are Pi-1 injected, just like for Riemannian manifolds, what we find is that if X is special, then its fundamental group is actually a subgroup of a rag. Okay, it's a subgroup of the fundamental group of the Salvetti complex, so it's a subgroup of a right-angled Artin group. We'll call a group G special if it's the fundamental group of a special cube complex, and actually the same thing, G is special if it's a subgroup of a rag. Okay, so I told you that a cat zero cube complex is a kind of high-dimensional tree. A special cube complex is a high-dimensional graph from a certain sense. And you can think of a special group as being a kind of relaxed version of a free group. I'm going to jump ahead. I'm sorry. I'm going to tell you about the next item in the on the menu. A wall space is a space together with a system of walls. Each wall kind of you have the stuff on the one side, a half space on one side, and a half space on the other side. So I have an example of a wall space. Maybe you should just concentrate on these two wall spaces right over here, right? The walls are these black dotted things, okay? And the set is the oval, okay? Sagiv, whose work I'm intimately connected to and building upon for many years now, Sagiv explained that every wall space is dual to a cat zero cube complex. So I'm going to soon tell you how you get cat zero cube complexes into the world of groups. So first of all, let's just talk about this for a moment. We all are familiar with the notion of the dual. Maybe actually this example is better. The second example is better. So the dual to this kind of black network over here, right? This black tiling, if you like, is this red tiling. Right, that I think for topologists is a very, very familiar type of picture, this dual, right? You can have a little zero cube for each complementary region, and two adjacent regions are joined by a one cube, right? So this red dual to this black wall space. And likewise, you have a dual to this guy over here. So the red object is the dual cube complex. But in general, Sagiv explained that if you have a collection of walls, so this collection of three families of walls, you get a dual. The definition is a little more complicated when you have large families of walls that pairwise self-cross. So I'm not going to define it, but it's actually just a nice generalization of a familiar dual. Okay, so when you have a bunch of walls, you get a cat zero cube complex that is dual to it. That was my message of this page. So I'm just going to remind people of calligraphs now very quickly. If you have a group with finally many generators, you get a calligraph. Its vertices are the elements of the group, and two vertices are joined by an edge. If the two group elements differ by a generator, I think this is familiar to many of us, just reminding, just in case someone walked into the wrong room. So here's an example of a group over here with two generators and these two relators, and here's a picture of its calligraph. Here's another, I see an exotic calligraph for Z squared, because I think that's a presentation for Z squared. The calligraph has a metric, actually it's a geodesic metric, right? You travel from point to point by wandering in the calligraph regarding each edge as a unit interval. It's something that I think is either you find natural or you've seen it before, I hope. And G is hyperbolic if, whenever you take a geodesic triangle in the calligraph, so you pick three points and you choose geodesics, shortest paths connecting those three points, to be hyperbolic means that there exists some uniform constant delta, so that each geodesic in each side of your geodesic triangle lies in the delta neighborhood of the union of the other two sides. Okay, so this is, you know, if all of the triangles kind of look like this one over here, they're all kind of thin, like triangles in a hyperbolic plane, then your group is hyperbolic. If its calligraph is a has the so-called delta thin triangle property. Okay, so that's a quick review of hyperbolicity and calligraphs, and I'm going to get back to these dual cube complexes. So back to Sagid's PhD thesis, actually. A codimension one subgroup, that's certainly an older idea that predates Sagid. A codimension one subgroup, I'll explain roughly, it's a group that cuts G in half. So the examples that you should be thinking of really are just codimension one pi one injective submanifolds is the example. That gives you a sufficiently rich class of examples so that you have some idea of what this means. Very easily, z to the n in z to the n plus 1 is a very good example. So even z inside of z squared, right? So you have this sequence of vertices, which maybe corresponds to some infinite cyclic subgroup in z squared. And if you take a kind of coarse, if you take a little finite neighborhood of those vertices, then and you remove it, then you have two infinite spaces on either side of it. Okay, so that's what a codimension one subgroup is. Now, Sagid's construction takes as input a codimension one subgroup and gives as output an action of your group on a cat zero cube complex. So I already told you that if you could just find a bunch of walls, if you can create a space with a bunch of walls, then the dual to that is going to be a cube complex, it's going to be a cat zero cube complex. So it's just a matter of realizing that if you have a codimension one subgroup, then you can kind of, that codimension one subgroup kind of gives you a wall, right? Because there's the stuff on the one side of it and the stuff on the other side of it when you thicken it up slightly. And the group, if you translate that subgroup around, you get a whole bunch of cosets, right? And now you have a collection of walls. The group is permuting, the group is acting on that collection of walls that came from your codimension one subgroup. So this is a kind of heuristic picture of where the codimension one subgroup was just an infinite cyclic subgroup in maybe a genus two, the fundamental group of a genus two surface. So you get the hyperbolic plane, the calligraph looks kind of like the hyperbolic plane. Well, you take the dual cube complex to that, and since the group is acting on the set of walls so nicely, it's going to end up acting on the dual cube complex. Okay, so now I've reviewed Sagid's construction, and this is this is one important source of cat zero cube complexes in group theory. Okay, from very important to me. Okay, so we heard about twice already, at least, about the celebrated work of Khan Markovich. I'll restate it. If you have a closed hyperbolic three manifold, then you can find pi 1 injective immersed in compressible surfaces inside, so they're actually very nicely geometrically embedded, and as they explained, not only can they find some such surfaces, but for each, actually you could find many of them. So in fact, for each circle in the two-sphere, the boundary of the universal cover of your three-manifold, of your hyperbolic three-manifold, for each circle in the two-sphere, you could find a collection of Kahn Markovich surfaces whose boundaries are getting very, very close to that circle. And that enables us, because of a theorem of Bergeron and myself, that actually Dufour obtained independently a little bit later, but independently, here's the theorem. If a group is hyperbolic, and suppose that any two, suppose you have a hyperbolic group, and not just a hyperbolic three-manifold, but any group, and suppose that for any two points in the boundary, so when you have a hyperbolic space, you can actually look at all geodesic, you can pick a point and look at all geodesic rays, infinite geodesic rays, you can topologize that, and you get what's called the boundary of the hyperbolic group. Typically, it's something like a Cantor set, or Menger curve, or some silly fractally object. So if for any two points in the boundary, you could find